I was asked by Canon Lewis that I should also share about my work in Africa. But before that, I will just very briefly mention the lessons this morning. The first lesson is about the beginning of the Passover feast. The Lord God Himself asked to give the unblemished, a perfect lamb's sacrifice, and gave instructions how to sacrifice, how to eat, and then they were set free from the bondage of Pharaoh, from Egypt. This is a preamble. What Jesus did for us, the lamb of the Passover feast, the perfect lamb who had no sin, no blemish, gave his life for me, for you, for you, for you, that by the shedding of his blood on the cross, as scripture says, the blood of Jesus Christ washes away our sins. We are made clean and whole to stand perfectly in the presence of Holy God. I pray this morning, as you approach the holy altar, you are washed away. Pray that you are washed away with the blood of Jesus Christ and made perfect and cleansed to stand in the presence of Holy God. Receive that life everlasting offered on the cross as you hold the bread, the body of Christ broken on the cross. May that life, the power of the Holy Spirit, enter in your lives. May this not just be ordinary Sunday. We just, you know, consider, oh, it is a Christian practice. We go for an hour to the church. But this morning will be maybe praying earnestly, seeking, because Jesus Christ is present. And he's there to cleanse you, bless you, empower you, renew you as a new person. Whoever is in Jesus Christ is a new person. Then the gospel is, Jesus knew that we are human beings. There will be disputes, there will be issues, we will be debating. On those issues, we'll disagree, and those disagreements can lead to our broken relationships. In the theological language, broken bonds of affection. So, Jesus is giving us a model. Don't get so upset, so angry, that you lose to look at the face of your brother and sister and learn to listen to each other and to forgive each other and reconcile. In the book of Ephesians, you know, the Apostle Paul says, our ministry is, at the end of all these, you know, kind of debates and disagreements, Jesus Christ calls us, because he is the one who reconciled us on the cross with the Father. So our ministry is given by our Lord, by our Master, by our Savior, our ministry of reconciliation. To forgive each other, to love each other as brothers and sisters. Now I'm coming to share with you my ministry. I was in Africa in South Sudan. The month of May and June, I was here last time, last April. I served as a bishop in the Diocese of Old South Sudan, under Archbishop of Sudan. And this is a country which has been involved in war for 50 years. The Islamic government for many, many years imposed on them Sharia law and forced them to deny the name of Jesus. And 2.1 million were killed and 4 million were made refugees. But these people where I served in the south of Sudan. North of Sudan is Arab, and the south of Sudan is all black Africans. And people in South Sudan kept saying, when the Islamic government was forcing to deny the name Jesus, they kept saying, Jesus Christ is my Lord. 4 million were uprooted as refugees. That is what convinced me to become their bishop 5 years ago after serving for 44 years, 44 years as a priest. And then in my old age, I'm close to 74, I will serve these people who have lost everything, but their faith is like a steel. They kept saying, Jesus Christ is my Lord, and over 2 million people gave their lives as martyrs of Jesus Christ. They lost their roads, their schools, their hospitals, their jobs, their crops, their animals, everything. And I visited them first time in 1996. And I entered into South Sudan illegally with an African bishop, Nathaniel Durang from South Sudan. I saw people naked without food for days. Their crops, their homes were all burned. Nakedness. But they gathered in the war zone area where we had entered among our Christian community from Kenya. Africa. Illegally we walked on foot and saw hundreds and thousands carrying wooden crosses in their hands and singing right in front of us when we held worship services in an area where we were illegal. But our people gathered and they're singing, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
The cross before me, the world behind me. Little electricity, no running water. And I lived there under temperature 105, 110. Yesterday was 100 temperature, and it was terribly hot. But over there, I was living for 2 months, May and June, the hottest month, under temperature 110, all the time sweating. But I was visiting churches, praising God with people, and preaching and teaching and laying hands on people for healing. There where I sleep, it's called St. Andrew's Compound, St. Andrew's Cathedral Compound. And in that compound, there is a cathedral made of mud walls, but long from here all the way to the wall green, very long cathedral. And 3,000 to 4,000 people sit low on the ground and no electricity, and very hot inside. On Sundays, there are 3,000 to 4,000 people will gather. And I remember on June 18th, I was preaching, and then I invited the people to rise up and hold their wooden crosses in their hands, and hundreds, if not thousands, were holding wooden crosses and singing, "I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back." These people had gone through great suffering and agony and faced death and starvation, but remained faithful followers of Jesus. The place where I sleep, St. Andrew's Cathedral, in the same compound, there is St. Andrew's Primary and High School. There are 3,700 children in primary and high school. And these children, I noticed in the last 3 years, had no water ever in that school present. So children under temperature of 110 have no glass of water to drink. So 3 years ago, I prayed to the Lord and decided, these are also my children. Lord, provide funds that we can build a well and provide, you know, water for these people. So this time, I was able to dig a well and build a tower and then put two big tanks of 5,000 gallons each so children can drink fresh water 24 hours and can wash and cook with clean water. Then and that money comes from the parishes of Central Diocese of Central Florida. Churches all over the diocese, when I visit for 2 months, I'll be staying here at the Trinity House and visiting every Sunday different churches. And whatever people give, none of that money goes in my pocket for my needs. I receive pension from the Episcopal Church, I live on that, but every penny the diocese sends to Church Missionary Society, we send, and they take it to South Sudan for the education of children, for, you know, providing water, providing medicine, because they were Nile is next door, and many people suffer, many children suffer from malaria. So now we have, when I was there in the last 2 months, we provided medicine for the prevention of malaria for all those 3,700 children. 4 years ago, I opened a center, sewing center, for the empowerment of young ladies. And now we have trained 100 ladies to learn, you know, the skill to tailor. Now they can actually earn a little bit money. 80% and more people are jobless because of 50 years of war. Poverty is everywhere, so I'm trying to help to empower young ladies, medicine for children, water for children, and beside teaching, preaching, that's the work I was doing. My brothers and sisters, please pray for me. As in my old age, I minister among them, and sometimes it becomes very difficult serving. But we have definitely, with the help of our people in Central Florida, here in the diocese, we have provided them a project of $25,000 to dig a well. Because everything comes from a couple of hundred miles on a dirt road from Uganda. Because this country infrastructure is 100% destroyed by the Muslim government, because they want Christians to be killed or to be converted to Islam. But these are faithful brothers and sisters as disciples of Jesus Christ. I'm sharing this story with you that under difficult circumstances, these people remain faithful. We live in a country, we are blessed by many blessings of God. And what a beautiful church. I've been told that $140,000 are going to be spent on the repair of the roof. And think about where I was. They do not have even $14 in their pocket. But we thank God for God providing us these blessings for freedom in this country and place of worship. Pray that you may also do the work of the evangelists. God may set fire in our hearts to invite others to bring to the worship of Jesus Christ, who has given that encouragement that 2 million people gave their lives to maintain their faith and say, I have decided, we have decided to follow Jesus. May you all remain faithful disciples of Jesus, that the light of Christ may shine through the lives of the people of St. John's Episcopal Church here in Kissimmee. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.